Welcome. Electronic mail. Today I am going to discuss about sending and receiving mail, architecture, user agent, MIME, mail transfer agent, mail access agent, and web-based mail. Electronic mail. It is one of the most popular internet services. At the beginning of the internet era, the messages were sent by electronic mail, but they were too short and consisted of only text. But today, as you know, electronic mail consists of text, audio, video, or attached messages, attached files, etc. To explain the architecture of email, I am going to consider four cases. Case 1. The sender and the receiver of the email are users or application programs on the same system. Means both the sender and receiver are connected directly to the same system. So here the administrator has created one mailbox, and this mailbox will store all the messages received. Actually, this mailbox is a part of the local hard drive itself. It's a special file. It is maintained as a special file with some permission restrictions. That means only the owner of the mailbox can access it. This means many people may be using the same system, but only the owners of the system mailbox can access the mailbox. When a sender, say user 1, needs to send a message to user 2, that is a receiver, the sender runs a program known as user agent to prepare the message. So message is prepared with the help of a program known as user agent, and it is stored in the receiver's mailbox. So I told already that here the sender and the receiver both are connected to the same system. Both are a part of the same system. And the sender creates a message and keeps it in the receiver's mailbox. And this message has sender and recipient mailbox addresses, means names of the files. Now the receiver can retrieve the contents of this mailbox at any moment as per his convenience. And he is also using the user agent. So from the figure, this can be the case 1, the situation of sender and the receiver connected to the same system and sending the email can be explained. Here this is the sender's side and here it is the receiver's side. Both the sender and the receiver are connected to the same system. So here the client or the sender is using a user agent to create the message, and it is stored in the mailbox, and this mailbox can be accessed by the receiver whenever he wishes, and this retrieval is done with the help of the user agent. Now case 2. Here the sender and the receiver of the email are users or application programs on two different systems. So case 1, they are the users of the same system. So here we are changing the situation, that is the sender and the receiver are on two different systems. That means the message is to be sent over the internet. So we need two user agents, that is at the sender's side as well as at the receiver's machine, and message transfer agent to transfer from one system, the sender system, to the receiver system over the internet. Message Transfer Agent is termed as MTA. So coming to the process of sending a message, sender needs a user agent program as in the previous case, and to send his message to the system as his own sites, that is sender's user agent is creating a message and is stored in his own site. The system and this system that is stored in his own site at all, and this is sometimes known as the mail server. That is mail server at the sender's site. And this mail server usually uses a queue to store the messages waiting to be sent. That is, the user agent will create the message and these messages will be stored in the mail server at the sender's site. Now this message is sent or transmitted over the internet, and the receiver also uses a user agent program to retrieve the messages. And these messages are stored in the mailbox of the receiver's site or receiver's side. So here we need two message transfer agents, one client and one server. Like most client server programs on the internet, the server needs to run all the time because it does not know when the client will ask for a connection. On the other hand, the client need not be connected all the time. It may be alerted by the system when there is a message in the queue to be sent. And this figure clearly explains the situation. Here, this is a sending side and this is a receiver side, and here sender is connected to this system and the receiver is connected to this system, and they are connected through over the internet. Here the sender uses the user agent, also receiver uses the user agent at his site. And here it is a MTA client and here it is the MTA server, that is mail transfer agent client and mail transfer agent server. So here the sender uses the user agent to create a message, which in turn will invoke the MTA message transfer agent. And this message transfer agent, MTA client, in turn invokes or calls MTA server at the receiving machine. Or in other words, a connection is established between the MTA client and the MTA server. Meanwhile, the messages created by the sender are queued by the mail server at the sender's site. So now the MTA client sends these queued up messages over the internet to the sender's machine. And it is received by the MTA server and which is stored in the mailbox of the receiver. Now, whenever the receiver wants to retrieve this message, he will use the user agent, and from the user agent will help him to download or retrieve the messages from the mailbox. Case 3. The receiver is directly connected to his system. However, the sender is separated from his system. Separated in the sense the sender is connected to the system by means of a WAN or a LAN or something like that. So the sender needs a user agent to prepare the message as already discussed. This message is to be sent through the LAN or WAN because the sender is connected through a LAN or WAN. So the message created by the sender is to be sent through the LAN or WAN. And this is done with a pair of message transfer agents. You can call it as client and server. So it works as follows. Whenever the sender has a message to send, he calls a user agent in his sign, which in turn calls the message transfer agent client or MTA client. Now the MTA client establishes a connection with MTA server on the system, which is running all the time. Let us have a look at the figure, then we can come back. Here there is a user agent, and the sending side is here, receiving side is here. The sender is connected to the system through a LAN or a WAN, and the receiver is connected directly to the system. This is what I have told. Now, using the user agent, with the help of user agent, the sender creates a message, which in the user agent will, for this the user agent will call MTA client, which in turn will call MTA server. So MTA client establishes a connection with MTA server on the system, which is running all the time. So this is MTA server and the connection is established. The system at the sender's site will queue up all the messages. Now it has to use MTA client to send the message to the system at the receiver's side. That is, here MTA client will contact MTA server, and the messages are queued up, and MTA, and with the help of MTA client, it is to be transmitted or transferred to the MTA server at the receiver's site or receiver's system. At the receiver side, the system receives the message and stores it in the receiver's mailbox. This is shown here. It is stored in the receiver's mailbox. Now, whenever the receiver wants to retrieve it, he will invoke the user agent, and user agent will help him to retrieve the message from the mailbox. Case 4. This is the case when both the sender and receiver are connected to their mail server by a LAN or WAN. Means they are not directly connected. So once the message has arrived at the receiver's mail server, he has to retrieve it, or he can retrieve it. For this, he needs another set of client-server agents known as message access agent. That is the difference between the previous case. So here the client sends the request to the message access agent server, which is running all the time and requests the transfer of messages. When both the sender and receiver are connected to the mail server through a LAN or a WAN, we need two user agents, that is at the sender and the receiver, two pairs of MTAs, that is at the sending side and the receiving side, client and server at both the systems, and a pair of MAA. This is needed only at the receiver side, and this is the most common situation nowadays we are using. This can be explained with the help of this figure. Here, both the sender and the receiver are connected to their system through a LAN or WAN. So, in order to send, the sender will invoke the user agent, which in turn will call the MTA client. Now, MTA client has communication with the connection with the MTA server, which is ready always. And the message created by the user agent is queued up. Now, the MTA client will transfer the message in the queue over the internet to the MTA server at the receiver's side or receiver's system. And these messages are stored in the mailbox of the receiver. Now, to access this message in the mailbox, whenever the receiver wants, he will request the help of MAA client. MAA client will in turn contact MAA server in order to download this message from the mailbox to the receiver's site. And this is done with the help of user agent at the receiver's site. Now about user agent. So as we already discussed, in order to create a message or in order to retrieve a message, we need a user agent. So we can take or we can consider the first component of an electronic mail system as the user agent. It provides service to the user to make the process of sending and receiving a message easy. Actually, it is a software package or a program that can read, compose, forward, etc. That you may be familiar with that. That is, it can even handle mailboxes. So this figure shows the typical services of a user agent: composing messages, reading messages, replying to messages, forwarding messages, handling mailboxes. I'm sure that you all are familiar with all these steps in email. That is, composing means writing a mail, reading means we are checking the mail, we can give reply to a mail, and we can forward the mail received from some point, and even we can handle mailboxes. All these activities are done with the help of user agent. So first is composing a message. A user agent helps the user to compose the email messages to be sent out. Normally, most of the user agents provide a template on the screen to be filled by the user. That is, whenever you try to compose a message, you have to enter the recipient address, you have to enter the subject, you are entering the body, and for all these there are some provisions are made. And that is the template provided by the user agent. You are just filling up the blanks. Some user agents have even built-in editors, means they can do spell checking, grammar checking, etc. As you know, you even can import files or cut and paste data from somewhere else to your mail. And all these are allowed by user agent. Next is reading messages. So when you log in to your email account, you can see the inbox. That is, all the incoming mails are stored in the inbox. Or we are first checking the mail in the incoming mailbox. And when you try to check the details of the mailbox, we can see the mails as a one-line summary. Means each of the mails displayed there will contain at least the following fields: a number field, a flag field that shows the status of the mail, that is whether it is already read or it is a new mail, like that. The size of the message, the sender name, and optional subject field. And all these are provided by the user agent. Next, replying to messages. Reply means giving a response or sending a message to sender of a message. So once we read a message, we can send a message as a reply to the sender of the message. The user agent usually allows the user to reply to the original sender or to reply to all the recipients of the message. Forwarding messages. The difference between reply and forwarding is that forwarding means sending the message to a third party. Reply means replying to the sender. The user agent allows the receiver to forward the messages with or without extra comments to a third party. Next comes handling mailboxes. You may be familiar with the inbox where all the incoming mails are stored. Similarly, we have the outbox where all the sent mails are kept. So, there are two mailboxes created by the user agent, inbox and outbox. Actually, inbox and outbox are files with a special format that can be handled by the user agent. The mail stored in inbox as well as in outbox, both are kept there until they are deleted by the user. Most of the user agents today are capable of creating customized mailboxes. Now, coming to types of user agents, there are two types of user agents, command driven and UI based. Command driven. Actually, we are not using it today, or they belong to the early days of electronic mail, but still present as the underlying user agents in servers. Normally, they accept one character command from the keyboard to perform a task. For example, take the case of the command R, small letter R, at the command prompt. This is to reply to the sender of the message. And suppose we are typing capital R, this is to reply to the sender and all the recipients. Next is GUI based. All the user agents of modern email system are GUI based. And using GUI, user can interact with the system very easily. They have graphical components such as icons, menu bars, windows, etc. to make the services easy to access. Next is format of email. Here in the figure, you can see postal mail as well as email. Both contains the recipient address and the details. So coming to email format, here this portion mail from and the recipient to is known as the envelope. If we are comparing it with the actual postal mail, this is what we write on the cover, on the outside portion, that is on the cover. And here comes body and header, which together constitute the message. Body portion means the message which we actually want to communicate with the recipient. And the header portion contains normally from address, to address, and the subject, etc. So body, header together constitute the message. Now coming to email address, that is we have from address, to address are there, and email address, it is known as the email address, and this email address format is given here, localpath@domain name. Local part means address of the mailbox on the local site, and domain name is the name of the destination. To understand this easily, we can check this example. xyz@gmail.com. So xyz is the local site, address of the mailbox on the local site, and Gmail is the DN domain name of the destination. Now some additional points. Email can send messages only in 7-bit ASCII format, but this makes some problems because all the languages such as French, German, etc. are not supported by 7-bit ASCII characters. Also, it cannot be used to send binary files or video or audio data. So these are the problems we are facing. So email uses a supplementary protocol, MIME, that is Multipurpose Internet Mail Extension. Actually, what you are experiencing today is that you can send any type of file, video, audio, etc. This is possible because of the MIME. It is working there. So MIME allows non-ASCII data to be sent through email. MIME transforms non-ASCII data at the sender side to NVT ASCII data. So first of all, if there is any non-ASCII data, MIME is taking it from the user agent. It will transform it into ASCII data. Then it delivers them from delivers them to the MTA client to be sent through the internet. This is what I am telling about the sender side. That is, from the user agent, MIME takes it and transfers it into NVT ASCII data, and it is given to MTA client at the sending machine. And this is sent from the MTA client to the MTA server at the receiver machine through the internet. Now at the receiving side also, the same thing is to happen. That is, the incoming data is to be transferred back to non-ASCII format so that the receiver can read it. So this is explained using the figure. That is, from a user agent, this coming, it may include ASCII as well as non-ASCII code. MIME will take it and it will convert all non-ASCII code to 7-bit ASCII code. Then it is given to MTA, message transfer agent, at the sending side and sent over the internet, and it is received by the message transfer agent at the receiver side. From there, it is given to MIME. MIME will extract or translate all the required thing to non-ASCII code, which is given to the user agent. Means now the receiver is able to read it. Message transfer agent. So we are talking about message transfer agent, MTA client and MTA server, like that. So the protocol acting behind is SMTP, that is Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. As we have already discussed, actual mail transfer is done between message transfer MTA client at the sending side and MTA client at the receiving side. So message transfer agents are helping us to transfer the message. So to send a mail, a system must have the client MTA, and to receive a mail, system must have a server MTA. That is, we need a pair. So this figure shows where SMTP works. That is, from the sending side to the mail server, that is MTA. Sending side system, the sender is connected to his mail server through a LAN or WAN. So between these two SMTP acts, and from the MTA client to the MTA server at the receiver over the internet, also SMTP works. This is done by message transfer agent, and the protocol is SMTP. Now about the commands. Commands are sent from the client to the server, and this command is having a general format as keyword dot arguments. So it consists of a keyword followed by zero or more arguments. So arguments may be there or may not be there, and actually there are 14 commands. Some are mandatory, compulsory, and every implementation must support these commands. Some others are there, they are used, they are very much used and highly recommended, but not compulsory. And some other commands are there, which are seldom used. Responses. Responses are sent from the server to the client. It is actually a 3-digit code that may be followed by some additional information. Actually, there are 4 categories of responses: positive completion reply, positive intermediate reply, transient negative completion reply, permanent negative completion reply. And suppose our code is, response code is 500, then category is 5. Our response code is 435, category code is 4. That is, the leftmost digit of a code indicates the category. And here what I am written is syntax error, unrecognized command. That is, if the category code is 5, it means syntax error. That is, it is an unrecognized command. Now, the process of mail transfer has 3 phases: connection establishment, mail transfer, and connection termination. All this you know very well, so I am not going into any more detail. Now, message access agent MAA. SMTP is known as a push protocol. That is, it pushes the message from the client to the server. At the sending side, from the MTA client to the MTA server. That is, the direction of bulk data messages is from the client to the server. But at the receiver side, whenever the receiver wants to retrieve a message or wants to read a message, he has to take bulk amount of data, that is message, from the server to the client. That is, he has to pull messages from the server. So at the receiver side, or we will say as a third stage, that is, first stage is from user agent to mail server, from mail server or at the sending side to the mail server at the receiver side is the second stage, and both uses SMTP. And the third stage is retrieval of the message by the receiver from his mail server, and it actually needs a pull protocol for pulling the messages, that is bulk amount of messages, from the server to the client. That is, the bulk direction of bulk data is from server to client. So for this purpose, this stage uses a message access agent, MAA. So currently we are using 2 protocols for this, POP and IMAP. POP means post office protocol, and the current version is POP3, so we will say it as POP3. And IMAP means Internet Mail Access Protocol. Version 4 is nowadays using, so IMAP 4. So this figure shows where we are using POP3 and IMAP 4. We have already come across this picture, this figure. That is, from the user agent, the sending side from the user agent is connected to LAN or connected to the mail server through LAN or WAN. So here SMTP acts, and from the mail server to the mail server at the receiver over the internet also SMTP works. This much we have already discussed. Now coming to mail server to the user agent or to the client side. POP3 and IMAP are working. Now we can check one by one POP3 or Post Office Protocol version 3. It is simple and limited in functionality. So for the working of POP3 protocol, we have client POP3 and server POP3. So client POP3 software is installed on the recipient computer. That is where the recipient is sitting. The server POP3 software is installed on the mail server. That is, coming back to the figure, client POP3 is installed at the recipient computer and server POP3 is installed at this mail server. So mail access start with the client. When the user needs to download, that is, needs to access the email from the mailbox on the mail server. So everything is at the mail server. The receiver has to access the mail from the mail server. For this, the client's POP3 software opens a connection to the server. The client and server are to be connected. And for this, a TCP port 110 is used. That is, POP3 uses the port number 110. So once a connection is opened, it sends the username and password to the mail to access the mailbox. So from the user's side, it is done automatically. From the user's machine, the username and password are sent to the mailbox. Then the user can list and retrieve mail messages one by one. POP3 has two modes, delete mode and keep mode. In delete mode, the mail is deleted from the mailbox after each retrieval. In keep mode, the mail remains in the mailbox after retrieval. So that is the difference between the two modes. And actually, why we are using this? A delete mode is normally used when the user is working at a permanent computer. He is working at his own permanent computer and can save and organize the received mail after reading and replying. So there is no need of keeping the mail in the mailbox. So it is in the delete mode. Keep mode is normally used when the user accesses mails away from his primary computer. So the mail is read but kept in the system, that is, kept in the mailbox, system in the sense mailbox, for later retrieval and organizing. The figure shows the communication between POP3 server and POP3 client. So here it is a user client, user computer. User wants to retrieve a message from the mail server. So POP3 client will open a connection from the POP3 client to the POP3 server. After that, from the client, it will send the username, it will send the password. If there is a match, everything is fine and he can retrieve emails. Next, IMAP 4. It is Internet Mail Access Protocol version 4. It is similar to POP3, but it is having some additional features. Those additional features makes it more powerful and also complex. So before going to the additional features of IMAP, we can just check out the limitations of POP3. First one is, it does not allow the user to organize mails on the server. That is, the user cannot have different folders on the server, or user is not able to make any arrangements on the server. However, he can create folders or make arrangements in his own computer. There is no problem for that. But on the server, mail server, he can't do anything like that using POP3. And also another drawback is, POP3 does not allow the user to partially check the contents of the mail before downloading. That is, even before starting downloading the mail, if we are using only POP3, we can't check it partially. So these limitations are solved using IMAP. So the extra functions of IMAP are: user can check the email header prior to downloading. So header can be checked before downloading. Also, he can search the contents of the email. Searching is an important thing that IMAP is doing. Can search the contents of the email for specific string of characters prior to downloading. Even it is done prior to before starting download. And a user can partially download email. Partial downloading is also permitted, which is not in POP3. Then additional features are: a user can create, delete or rename mailboxes in the mail server. By using POP3, a user cannot do anything with the mail server. Here IMAP for by using IMAP for, a user can create, delete or rename mailboxes on the mail server. Even he can create a hierarchy of mailboxes in a folder for email storage. The last topic is web-based mail. Some websites today provide mail services to anyone who access the site. That is, mail services are provided to anyone who is accessing the particular site. So idea is, mail transfer from the browser to his mail server is done through HTTP. So transferring from browser to a mail server, browser in the sense where the user is accessing the email software, to his mail server is done through HTTP. Then after that, for creating a message, we have to send it. So transfer of message from the sending mail server to the mail receiving mail server, that is from the sender to the receiver, it is done using SMTP. That also we have discussed. And the message from the receiving server, that is web server, here it is a web server, to the receiver's browser, from the web server to the receiver's browser, is done through HTTP and it is not using IMAP or POP. So the change is in the third point, that is last phase. Instead of POP3 or IMAP, HTTP is used. So when the receiver needs to retrieve his emails, earlier we told the receiver is using IMAP or POP3 for retrieving the mail from the server. So here, when the receiver needs to retrieve his emails, he sends a message to the website. We are talking about the web-based mail. So the receiver is sending a message to the website. Now the website sends a form to be filled by the receiver. Actually, everything is done automatically, which includes a login name and a password. So whenever the user logins to his account and he is trying to retrieve his emails, and what happens is that he is sending a message to the website. Using web-based mail, he is sending a web message to the website. And now the website in turn shows or displays a form on his screen, which includes the login name and password. It will be sent to the website. And if the login name and password match, the email is transferred from the web server to the receiver's browser. Okay, it is transferred from web server to the receiver's browser, and that too in HTML format. Okay, that's all about email and web-based mail. Thank you.